what we learned before was that if f is epsilon concentrated on capital F, let's look at all functions which are epsilon concentrated on capital F. What is capital F here? It is a subset of
power set of
very nice.
And
it is a subset of penalties, correct?
Yes.
If f is if we take a look look at the class of functions which are epsilon concentrated on capital F, then f can be learned. We can figure out what f is in a small amount of time, polynomial in capital F and 1 minus 1 by epsilon. This is what we saw as a result. It was easy to understand what f was. Do you remember the technique? Actually, but just by looking at the theorem, you can guess what algorithm should work. If I tell you that f is epsilon concentrated on capital F, how would you want to figure out small f?
Ask 1 by epsilon queries.
Ask 1 by epsilon queries. Okay, you are only looking at the time complexity, but how will you use the fact that f is epsilon concentrated on capital F? Okay, suppose
just need to learn the coefficients of this family F.
Exactly. The idea was to estimate the Fourier coefficients of S in capital F. Right, in all this, we are assuming that capital F is small, so we can estimate each of the Fourier coefficients in capital F, and then our function is basically that those Fourier coefficients, those estimate of the Fourier coefficients multiplied by the parity, and then what? And then one more step. What was the last step? What should be output? Remember, F is
signum function.
Yes, the sine of. Because we were assuming it was a function which is outputting minus 1, 1, we take our estimate, it will output some value, minus 0.6, 0.7, whatever be the value, we just take the sign of it. And that would be our output. We showed that that function would actually be very, very close to small f with high probability. I just wanted to remind you that this was the technique. We estimated the Fourier coefficients of capital F. The capital F have lots of parity, or whatever number of parities. You wanted to estimate those parities, and it was easy to estimate a single Fourier coefficient. Why? How do we estimate a particular Fourier coefficient? What is the definition of F at S? Sorry? Right, but the other way to write it was this way, right? This is the same way. This is the inner product between f and chi s. That means I just take random samples from x and then output the average. That average will be close to this expectation because of which theorem? So this was the discussion last time also. Yes, that is correct. That in general, when you take the sum of random variables, it is close to the expectation. This statement is law of large number, but law of large number does not provide us with enough power. In this case, we are taking independent, identically distributed samples, so we can actually apply a much stronger theorem, which starts with C. Because it is written on the screen. So that theorem is
Chernoff.
Exactly. So this is something which is very good to remember. Like I think Watson now remembers this. What is law of large number? if you take a random variable, sum it up, then you expect that your value will be close to the expectation. This is true, this is law of large number, but if your variables are Boolean and they are identically distributed, mutually independent and identically distributed, you can get much sharper bounds. And in computer science, we mostly need those sharper bounds which follow function. This is a standard tool which is applied whenever we are separating. Anyway, this is what we saw last in the last lecture on learning theory. That if F is epsilon considered on capital F, then I can figure out my small. Let me make the question slightly more difficult. What if we don't know capital? Someone tells us that my f is, my small f is epsilon concentrated on very, very small number of predicates. I don't know which one. If I knew which one, it was easy. Correct? I will just, whatever predicates it was concentrated on, I will estimate the Fourier coefficient. This is what we saw before. Now, the problem is slightly different. We don't know what is capital F. We don't know on which parities my F is epsilon concentrated. What I know is that there is some subset of parities on which F is epsilon concentrated. Okay. This is what I know. F is epsilon concentrated on 2 parities, 10 parities, 15 parities, square root n parities, whatever. That is the kind of statement given to us. And still, we want to figure out small. And obviously, the idea is that, you know, if M is large, then I should take more time. If M is small, if the number of parities on which F is concentrated is small, then I should be able to figure out F very quickly. This is what we want to come up with. Now, can we apply whatever we have, what we learned before, like this estimating the Fourier coefficients, can we apply that to learn small F? What we saw,
we can try random subsets, but I mean the time complexity would go like quite large since the number of subsets could be exponential. So
exactly right. So I would have to probably estimate 2 to the power n kind of order of 2 to the power n kind of Fourier coefficients, and I will be done. That is not good. What we are going to see today is that still possible. We can still do this. Using something called Goldrick-Levin algorithm. What does Goldrick-Levin algorithm tell you? It doesn't directly tell you that we can learn a function, but that is just one of the applications of the mean. Even the natural statement of Goldrick-Levin, the original statement of Goldrick-Levin, is very interesting. It was designed so that you can output all large Fourier coefficients. Okay, this is the intuition which you should remember. You want to output all large Fourier coefficients. Now, let me make it more precise. This is the intuition. This is what we want to do. What Goldrick-Levin does is that you fix a threshold term. You pick up what is meant by large Fourier coefficients. You give it tau. It will output a list of parities such that F at S is greater than gamma. That was the goal. In actuality, it will output a list such that That means if your Fourier coefficient is big, then it is contained in my list. And if my Fourier coefficient is contained in the list, or the parity is contained in the list, then my Fourier coefficient is, okay, not big, but almost big. It has to be at least bigger than gamma by 2. This is what Goldrick-Levin achieves. I will let you stare at it for a minute. Are there any questions about the statement of Goldrick-Levin? Actually, there is a natural question which should be asked when you see a statement like that, but I will wait for you to ask that question.
So threshold means?
Threshold means, generally a threshold means like a level, right? The level above the level, you want to output the Fourier coefficients. Below the level, you don't care. So here I'm giving the threshold a name. The name of the threshold is tau. You can decide tau and give it to Goldrick-Levin. Depending on your gamma, depending on your tau, Goldrick-Levin will work and give you a list. The list will satisfy these two problems. It is the ideal case was that it had outputted all and only the parities whose Fourier coefficient was more than tau. This was the aim. It does something slightly different. It does output every Fourier coefficient which is big, but in the process, it might output some other subsets also, which are between gamma and gamma by. So it is almost serving its purpose. We were supposed to output only and all the Fourier coefficients which were big. It definitely outputs all the Fourier coefficients which are big, but gives us a few extra, which might not be very big. They will be almost big. Almost big means they will at least be gamma by 2. Think of it this way. You can have three kind of Fourier coefficients, or think of two levels, gamma by 2. If your FTS is here, then it will definitely be in the list of Goldrick-Levin. If your FTS is here between gamma by 2 and gamma, then what do we know?
May or may not be in the list.
Yes, it might be or might not be in the list. There is no guarantee. What about if FTS is here?
Not there.
Will not be. Okay. So any questions about Goldrick-Levin? Is it clear what it is doing? Barsho?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if it is clear, then let me ask a question. My claim is that it is sufficient to run Goldrick-Levin and learn the function f, which is epsilon concentrated, on some small number of parities. Okay. Before I do that, there is a significant detail which is missing from the statement of the theorem. Can someone tell me what is that?
Time complexity?
Yes, because if you are given enough time, then you can find the perfect list also, right? Obviously, I should not be allowed a lot of time. So the point is that this will be done in poly 1 by tau. And And this makes sense. If tau was big, if you wanted to say, oh, how many Fourier coefficients are there which are bigger than 1? Your answer would have been?
Zero,
nothing, right? Because F is Boolean. But intuitively, if tau is big, then there are very few Fourier coefficients. It might be easier to output. And this is what you see in Gold. There is another important difference. The previous theorem about learning, which we saw, which I had explained, required only random access. On the other hand, Goldreich-Levin requires query access. That means I only give access which I want. I'm not, if I'm given random access, then I can't figure out these big Fourier coefficients. I need to be able to give an X and get an X. This is the main difference. Given a query access and a threshold tau, I will output a list which is almost the list of all large Fourier coefficients. Okay. Now, knowing this, my question is, why is it sufficient? Suppose someone tells you that you have an F which is epsilon concentrated on small number of parities, 10 number of parities.
Then we can make tau to be epsilon by, okay, so there was this problem in assignment, we can use that maybe. Where we were given the summation of Fourier one norm and were asked to prove this thing. So there we can use that. We can give tau to be epsilon by that some Fourier one norm.
So, okay, good. But it's actually much simpler. We will just run Goldreich-Levin with gamma equal to square root of epsilon by m. Remember, m is the number of Fourier coefficients on which our thing is epsilon constant. Once I do this, what I can assure you is that I will get a function which is 2 epsilon concentrated on M. I will get a list of Fourier coefficients such that F is 2 epsilon concentrated on that list. And once I have that list, then I can apply my old learning algorithm. Remember, if I knew on what parities my function is epsilon concentrated, I could always learn. The problem in this case was I didn't know exactly which parities my function was epsilon concentrated. Goldreich-Levin will just do that. It will output L, and then my function will be guaranteed to be 2 epsilon concentrated on capital. What is the proof? Let's look at the concentration of F outside M. Okay? Is the question clear? You are given a function. I run Goldreich-Levin on it with gamma is equal to square root of epsilon by M. Correct? Now, I get L, a list. The claim is that F is highly concentrated on that list. I want to prove that F is 2 epsilon concentrated on L. The Fourier weight outside L is at most 2 epsilon. So let's look at how F's Fourier weight is distributed, right? So I had M. So let me just change. There were m subsets on which F was epsilon concentrated. Let's say the list of parities were this, such that this was equal to, and we have figured out L. Now, if my function is inside L, I'm okay. I'm fine because I want F to be highly concentrated on F. So if a Fourier coefficient is inside L, I have no problem. The other two cases is, it is not in L, but in M. So think of it this way. This is the list of all parities. This is M. This is L. If my function is here, if my subset is here, I have no problem. What can I say about Fourier coefficients here? Outside M. What do I know?
Less than double.
Less than epsilon.
The magnitude is smaller than half of square root epsilon by M.
No, that has nothing to do with square root epsilon by M. I was given that F was epsilon concentrated on some F subsets, right? So that means anything outside this script M has weight at most epsilon.
I thought it is outside L. Okay.
No. See, again, the guarantee we were given was that F was epsilon concentrated on some M. We are outputting some L. And now our task is to show that F is epsilon concentrated or 2 epsilon concentrated on this capital. The guarantee was that F was epsilon concentrated on some small subset, right?
Yes.
Right. So that small subset, I'm calling this script F. So we know, not just that, even if you look at things which are outside M, even this, all this is at most epsilon. This is what we are given. But I just care about things which are outside M and outside. What about elements inside this? How much can they concentrate? How much can they contribute to the Fourier? They are not in L, right? That means their value is
smaller than half of.
This is less than gamma by 2, right? So their value is less than gamma, sorry, right? So this is less than epsilon by M. For anything which is not in L, its Fourier coefficient, its Fourier weight cannot be more than tau. That means its square could not be more than epsilon. And how many things could be there in this 2?
M.
Right.
So there should be 1/4 factor right there.
No. See, what does Goldreich-Levin assure?
L contains all those, like, okay, got it.
Right. It out. We might have elements outside L which have Fourier weight 3 tau/4. If something has weight 3 tau/4, it might be in L, it might not be. Right. Is there a confusion?
Got it.
So good. So that means this is good. We have found a list on which my function is highly concentrated. And then I know the description of L. I can learn L. The only problem is, what if this L is very, very large? Right? Trivially, I could just take L to be set of all Fourier coefficients. This is true on the set of all Fourier coefficients. My F is zero concentrated. Right? So my L should be small. Then only I can apply my machine learning algorithm, right? The learning algorithm which I had learned in the previous class. I can only apply it if my L is small, because the complexity runs in terms of N. So my L should be polynomial in 1/ε. And how can I bound the size of L? why can I say that size of L is small? Small means polynomial in 1 by epsilon and capital.
Since the magnitude is large and their sum has to be less than or equal to 1.
Great. Very good. This is just simple Parseval, right? Everything in L has weight at least gamma by 2. Right? So how many elements could be there in L?
Four by tau square.
I think there is no gamma on the screen. I'm just saying gamma instead of tau. I'm sorry. Okay. So is this clear? This follows from Parseval. If you understand this, then the only thing remaining is to show Goldreich lemma. And then we know how to learn functions which are epsilon concentrated on some unknown small set of L. Any questions about why this is sufficient? We were able to show that if we figure out all Fourier coefficients bigger than tau, bigger than square root epsilon by m, then my function has to be epsilon concentrated on that list. And that list has to be small. It is all I. Questions on this? Otherwise, I will move to the proof of Goldreich. Okay, if it is fine, then tell me what did Goldreich-Levin achieve, except Udit. Anyone else? What did Goldreich-Levin achieve? What did it do?
In polynomial time, it was basically able to identify an L of concept class. I mean, with the assurance of course that we have a strict L from the string of small polynomials.
Right, it was able to figure out a list such that it contained all the big Fourier coefficients, and anything which was in L was at least gamma by 2. Right, this was the statement of Goldreich. What we have done is to show that using Goldreich-Levin, we can make a learning algorithm for functions which are epsilon concentrated on small number of factors. Our only task now is to show how to figure out Goldreich-Levin. Given f and tau, how should I output L in time poly n 1 by tau? This is the objective. This is the remaining objective for the class 2. You are given f, you are given a threshold. I want to output all the big Fourier coefficients, almost all the big Fourier coefficients.
So we should also prove that it is 2 epsilon concentrated, right?
This I did, right? Because there are only two possibilities. Either I will be outside M, or I will be in M but not in L. And both of them can be, the Fourier weight could at least be epsilon.
Okay. Yeah.
So the total weight is 2 epsilon.
Okay.
Yeah. So now I know it is I have a learning algorithm if I can figure out Goldreich. Okay. What would be your strategy of going about Goldreich-Levin? What do we know? We can estimate one Fourier coefficient, right? How did we estimate one Fourier coefficient. We just learned it in today's class. How did we estimate a Fourier coefficient?
Using the expectation.
Using the expectation, just apply Chernoff, right? So we know how to estimate one Fourier coefficient, but if we want to find all big Fourier coefficients, we might as well have to estimate all 2 to the power n Fourier coefficients. But that is very, very expensive. This is not a great solution. The idea would be to start with a bucket with all the Fourier coefficients. What is the Fourier weight of this bucket? If the bucket contains one, right? It contains all the Fourier weights, so the weight is one. Now I will have a way to divide it into two buckets, right? So every Fourier coefficient from the bucket goes into exactly one of the buckets. Again, I would want to estimate what is the Fourier weight. This is not clear. This is going to be the main result, that somehow we can estimate Fourier weight of these smaller buckets. But if I can do that, I will estimate the Fourier weight. If it is big, I will keep the bucket. If it is small, then I will ignore it. Then again, divide it. And then finally, I will have buckets which contain just one element, and that will be our n. Okay? This is the idea. Now, let me show you all parts of this idea. Idea is that we can somehow estimate Fourier coefficients in bulk. We can have big buckets of Fourier coefficients. Again, it cannot be an arbitrary bucket, but they will have some structure. Those structured buckets could be estimated. Let me define those buckets. A bucket is defined by a K. K is a number between 1 and n, 0 and n, and a subset of first k elements. Okay? My bucket is defined by these two things. And what Fourier coefficients are lying inside that bucket? All subsets of type S union T, where S is, S, which I talked about, and T is a subset of K plus 1, 2. So think of this bucket. I know what I want from 1 to K. Rest, you can decide. If I take all those Fourier coefficients and put them in a bucket, that will be WS, K. The weight of that bucket is WS, K. Now, in the future, we can think of it as a subset as well as a number. A number means the weight of the bucket. Right? Is this bucket clear?
So, the subset concept is not clear. Could you repeat, please?
What is capital S?
How is WSK is a subset?
It's a subset of parities. It's all the elements which are contained in the bucket, right? I can take it to be all S union T, where T is an element of, is a subset of K plus 1. All sets of type S union T, where S is this fixed capital S and T is any subset of K plus 1 to the power 2n. Right? I can think of WS, K as this bucket also. Or I can think of the weight of this bucket. what is the size of WS, comma K?
Same as the power set, size of power set of K plus 1 to N.
Which is?
2 to the power N minus.
To the power n minus, correct?
And S is any subset of K.
One two. Yeah, that is important, right? S cannot have any element from K plus 1 2. Okay. Now, to start with, assume we can estimate WS, and I will give you the algorithm. Okay, then we will see how to estimate S comma. To start with, assume we can estimate any such bucket, any bucket WS. Okay. By the way, in this notation, what is the bucket which contains all the Fourier coefficients?
W phi and zero.
Very good. Right? Everyone sees that. W1, W phi 0 is the set of all Fourier coefficients. Now, remember the idea? We will start with all Fourier coefficients, divide that into two subsets, two parts. This is the set of all subsets which what is the property?
Do not contain one.
Which do not contain. This is the subsets. This is the set of all subsets which contain. And then we will estimate. We will estimate what is the Fourier weight here. What is the Fourier weight here? Remember, we have a black box. We have some magic box which lets us estimate this, right? So we assume that we have a magic box which lets us estimate WS for any K address. Okay, estimate with required accuracy. We will worry about those parameters later, but assume that you can figure out the value of WS comma. Right? So our algorithm will look like, start with W phi 0, divide it into two parts, estimate both. And then what do you want to do? If the estimate is low, then we will
ignore that part and continue right. Another part.
For the another part, if it is high, then we will again subdivide and then again estimate, right? This was the structure. In general, if I'm at any stage, I have WS, comma K, these are the two subsets I will divide. In one subset, K plus 1 will be present. In another bucket, no subset with K plus 1. Right? So you pick this bucket. Look at all the Fourier coefficients, all the parities which have K plus 1. They go on the right. You take all the parities which do not have K plus 1. They go on the left. This is the division I am doing in this one. And then once again, I will estimate. Once again, I will ignore or continue depending on what is the value, right? So I will discard a bucket if estimate is gamma square. Ideally, I should discard a bucket if the estimate is less than gamma square, correct? If WSK is less than gamma square, then that bucket has no meaningful Fourier coefficient for me, and I should discard, right? In this case, I will, just because my estimate might have some error, for that, I will say that, if it is less than gamma square by 2, then definitely no good Fourier coefficient is contained in my bucket. Throw the bucket. So at every stage, look at these buckets, split them into two if the estimate is high, otherwise, ignore. And we keep doing this process procedure, and when we finish, we will just be left with single element buckets. This is going to be our n. Every bucket will have just one parity each, and that parity is my n. Those parities, the list of all those parities which are left, is my n. There are many things which are not clear. Why is it working? Why do we get all the elements which are bigger than tau? And why do we get all the elements? Why do we not get any element which is less than tau by 2? That is not clear. We will see that. And why is it running efficient? And obviously, how do we estimate WS comma? There are many questions unanswered, but intuitively, is this process key? You take buckets, keep dividing them. If the bucket has low weight, throw it. Finally, every bucket will have just one single element left. Use that. That is the list output.
How did we come with this term tau square by 2?
Yes, that I will show you next. The idea is that actually we wanted to discard everything which was less than tau square, right? If the Fourier effect is more than tau, then the Fourier weight should be more than tau square. So anytime bucket weight is less than tau square, we should have thrown it away.
Yeah, okay.
But in this case, our estimate is going to have some error, right? Generally, when we estimate Fourier coefficients, when we estimate one Fourier coefficient, the value will not be exact. It will be close to the exact value, right? So account for that error. That's why I am putting it as gamma square. But I will formally prove that this gamma square by 2 will work. I'm just giving you an intuition why I did not put it as gamma tau square. Why did I put it as tau square? So let's first don't worry about how big a list is, how much time I will take. Let's worry about what I will get in my list. Okay. Remember that I discard if the Fourier weight is gamma square. Another thing which I will assume is that I am estimating WS comma K with error at most gamma square by 4. Okay, I didn't tell you how I am estimating WS comma K. We will talk about that. But at this point, just assume that I am estimating where the error could be at most gamma square. Are these two points clear? We discard if the bucket's Fourier weight is gamma square by 2, and our estimate is correct with error at most gamma square by 4. Knowing these two things, suppose my S is such that F at S is more than gamma. That means any bucket containing S, what can I say about its weight?
At least gamma square.
At least gamma square. That means when I will estimate it, its weight will be at least
3 gamma square. Gamma square.
That means it will never be discarded. Agreed? Are you okay with this? Right? If my bucket contained S, then its weight should have been at least gamma square. When I had estimated, since my error was gamma square by 4, the estimate would be correct with, estimate would be at least 3 gamma square by 3 tau square by 4. What is wrong with me? 3 tau square by 4. And that's why it will never be discarded. What if S is element of L? Right? That means my estimate would have been more than any bucket which has S. If it is still in L, that means the estimate would have been more than tau square by 2, right? Otherwise, I would have discarded it. But if the estimate is more than tau square by 2, That means the actual weight would have been more than
tau square by 4.
Tau square by. This implies F at S is more than
tau by 2.
Tau by 2. This is showing that I will only get S's which I like, which I wanted to in gold rate. That is completely fine. Okay.
And because we are taking the those buckets which have only one element, we can say this, right?
The final, yeah, the second part, yes.
Yeah, second part, yes. Okay.
Right. So this algorithm is definitely working, but what could be the problem? So correctness is fine, but what could be an issue with Goldreich-Levin with the algorithm? It might take a lot of
time.
Might take a lot of time. And why will it take a lot of time? Because it might be doing a lot of splits. Right? So let's look at running time. At any point of time, what can I say about number of buckets? Remember, what do? I split if the estimate is small, less than gamma square by 2. I discard it. Otherwise, I keep the buckets. And another thing is, can I have buckets which share two Fourier coefficients?
Yes, it can.
No. Okay, let's look at how we were doing it.
For since like the subsets could have been same. Okay, the element k plus 1 was not.
Right, so remember how we, what we did was we took this bucket and made partitioned it into two parts, right? So we cannot have two elements common between two subsets. At any point, if I look at a list, two elements cannot have a parity common. Because what I'm doing is exactly, I start with all the parities and then I partition them, right? W51 disjoint union W11 is equal to W50. Similarly, WS K plus 1 disjoint union. That means these two sets are disjoint and their union is the complete bucket. So there is no way I can get extra elements. I can get common elements. If there were two common elements, their parents should have common elements. If their parents had common elements, this will give us a contradiction, right? You can never have two elements common. At any point, if you look at a bucket, look at the list of buckets which you have at any point of the algorithm, no two buckets can have a common parity. So then what can I say about the number of buckets?
If the k steps have been there, so 2 to the power k at most buckets would be there.
No, but that is not good. Right? Because if I have n steps, then it will become 2 to the power n. What I want is in terms of tau, right?
Okay, so this is the number of buckets that would be left after the algorithm is over, right?
Right, not algorithm is over at any stage, right? When I have discarded, okay. Yeah. So start with one, split it. Now estimate. After the estimate, whichever one the ones are small, discard. Then again, take the another one, take the remaining ones, again split them. Then look at the weights. discard them and things like that, right? So after discard, at every level, how many buckets could be there? Remember, every bucket has weight at least. What do I know? The bucket has not been discarded. That means it has weight at least
1,000 square.
So then how many buckets can I have?
2 by 1,000 square.
Yeah. So it was almost 2 by 1,000 square, but remember, our estimate was wrong with error 1,000 square by 4. So the actual weight of the bucket was more than 1,000 square by 4. Our estimate was more than 1,000 square by 2, but the actual weight should have been more by 1,000 square by 2. And since the sum of the weights is 1, I will have at most 4 by 1,000 square. Is this clear? If every bucket has weight 1 by 10 and total weight of the bucket is 1, then how many buckets can be there?
At most 10.
This is what? Every bucket has weight at least 1,000 square by 4. This is what we know. If the estimate was less than 1,000 square by 2, I would have discarded it. And if the estimate is more than 1,000 square by 2, then the actual value will be at least 1,000 square by 4. Then how many buckets could be there? 4 by 1,000 square. Because the total weight of the buckets should add up to 1. And how many levels are there of this split? You know, you start with a set which had n elements. Every time one element you are taking care of. So that means if I look at a path, it can have at most n splits for each set. Right? This is in some sense trivial. If I look at any path in this tree, it can have at most n splits, right? The depth is at most n because I have n elements. That means I had total 4n by tau square nodes in this graph. That means the total number of estimates would have been at most 8n by tau. See that it is poly n 1 by tau. So the number of estimates are only 8n by tau square. If I can do every estimate efficiently, if I can make every estimate in this much time, then I am done. Questions about this running time. Look at this tree. There are n, the depth of this tree is n, right? Not a complete binary tree because I will be discarding many of the buckets. At each level, the number of buckets are at most 4 by tau square. And since the depth is n, there are at most 4n by tau square. Now, anything which I have estimated must have been a child of one of the nodes in this graph. That means total 8n by tau square estimates I would have done in worst case. The important thing is it is poly n 1 by tau as I require. Is this okay?
Yes.
What are we left with?
prove that we can estimate WSK.
Very good. We are only left with that magic box to estimate WSK. And what should we use there?
Chernoff bound.
We will use Chernoff bound, but also restrictions. Remember, we talked about this. This is an application of restrictions, right? And whatever we have seen till now, there is no restriction. These were just simple Parseval identities, divide and conquer. Right? We want to estimate WSK. Remember, this was the definition of WSK. The question is, can we think of WS, K as an expectation over some Fourier function? If I can do that, then using Chernoff bound, I will be able to estimate WS, K. And this is where the restrictions will come about. I will create functions using restricted functions. I will come with a restricted function whose Fourier coefficient f at s in expectation would give us this. That is the entire idea of estimating WS. Do you want to guess? What restricted function am I going to talk about?
What do you mean by Fourier coefficients and expectation would give this value?
So, the expected value of f restricted of s, that would be this quantity.
Okay.
Now, I want to ask, what is this restriction? The restriction is obviously random. So, do you want to take a guess? I will tell you in next 1 minute. But
we restrict the first some parities belonging to 1 to k subset of 1 k?
No, the other way, right? Because that has to remain. It should remain as a function of first k variables.
Okay.
Right? F at s. Yes. So you are actually running over everything outside first k. So this is what we will need. If you remember the definition, this is saying that this is going to be a function on first k variables such that the last variables are set to this. So z is a fixed string. You are fixing the n minus k variables, the last n minus k variables. So z is an element of minus 1, 1 to the power n. Okay. So the weight of s, k is expectation of my Fourier coefficient, Fourier weight, where my last n minus k coordinates are fixed right. And let's try to see. I actually probably gave a proof of it a few days back, but let's do it again. What is the Fourier expression? This is the Fourier expression, correct? Right. Now, again, club the terms which are inside, which are, when I fix z, some of the terms will be clubbed to each other. This is what we saw yesterday also, right? If I assign last k values, these are simple parities, these are just one single variable parities. If I assign them the value, then few coefficients will get merged together, correct? What will be those coefficients? Are you okay with this? This is just a simple clubbing of variables. Do you need a proof of this equality? This is some polynomial in xk plus 1, xk plus 2 till xn. The second equality is very, very simple. I'm just clubbing the things which are going to give me the coefficient of chi sx. The same thing which happened yesterday. Once we fix some variables, few parities come together. And this is exactly the description of the parities which will come together. Is that okay? Anyone who has a doubt in this? Okay. And now, what can you say about this? What is this? This you know by Fourier analysis. If I take a polynomial and I ask what is the sum of Fourier coefficients, what is that?
Sum over like 1 by 2 to the power n summation over all x fx square.
Correct.
Yes.
Right. And another name for PSZ is F hat KZ of S. Right? Because when you restrict the function, this is going to become the Fourier coefficient of chi SX. Correct? This proves equation number one. By Parseval's, this summation f at s union t whole square is expected value over z, psz whole square. But what is psz? Psz is the Fourier coefficient of the restricted function when I substitute the value of z. So I can replace psz with f at s of the restricted function. That gives me the equation number. We are almost done. We have written it as an expectation of the restricted function. How do we estimate the restricted function? I'm going to tell you next. But is the equation one clear? Questions? Okay. Then let's just talk about this. What is this value? What is this Fourier coefficient? F hat KZ S is expected over y. Now y is going as a k variable. Chi s y f k restricted to z of y. This is by definition, right? This is by the definition of Fourier coefficients. But this is just f of yz. Again, by definition. That means if I take the square of this quantity, the square of f at k z square, this becomes, you take the expectation over 2, y comma y prime, and just write out the two multiplications. Is equation number 2 clear? Okay, questions about equation number 3. This is just the definition of the Fourier coefficient. F at restricted function is a function on k variables. That's why this is the definition of its Fourier coefficient of s. And then we just notice what was the definition of the restricted function. F of k restricted to zy is just f of yz. We take a square, that means we are taking expectation over two independent y and y prime. Putting 2 in the previous formula, we again get WSK as an estimation of some plus minus 1 random variable. To pick a random z in minus 1 comma 1 to the power n minus k, to pick a random y in minus 1 comma 1 to the k, a y prime in minus 1 comma 1 k, and ask these values. You can ask, you have a query access, so you can ask f of y comma z, you can ask f of y prime comma z. This is where I need the query access. I'm asking f y comma z and f of y prime comma z. I'm not asking random f of x is, random of f of y. And since I can do query access, I can estimate these things, and just by Chernoff bound, I will get f. With the required, there will be some error in the estimate. I can get the estimate with this tau square by 4, but to estimate it with tau square by 4, the amount of error will be exponentially small. And even if I have all my estimates, remember the number of estimates I did, what was a10 by tau square. So for all those, if I add my exponential error, this is again going to be very, very small. This is where I use the strongness of Chernoff bounds. I show that the probability of error will be exponentially small. So even after applying union bound with very, very high probability, all my estimates will be correct with error up to tau square by. This is the second time we are doing the same thing. When we estimated one single Fourier coefficient, again the idea was the same. This shows we can estimate WS comma K. If we could estimate WS comma K, then we can finish Goldrich level. To conclude, what we learned today was we can output big Fourier coefficients. This algorithm is known as Goldreich method. Given a threshold tau, we can output a list which contains all the big Fourier coefficients, and it might have some Fourier coefficients which are between tau and tau by 2, but nothing small. This is what Goldreich Levin lets us do. Using Goldreich Levin, we can learn f if the concept class is of all functions which are epsilon concentrated on small number of subsets. If you just give me the guarantee that f is epsilon concentrated on 100 subsets, I can learn f very fast. That is what it lets you achieve. The argument from last two classes is that this analysis of parities, these restrictions, allows us to prove many wonderful results. We saw the machinery of restrictions of parities as vector space, and we saw two applications. From next time, we will start with a completely different topic. We will introduce some new measures of complexity. This chapter has ended. even if these things are not clear to you for last four classes, don't worry about it. From next class, we will start afresh. And we will see this very recent result of Huang in 2 weeks, which proved sensitivity conjecture, which was like in 2019. So it was a remarkable result. It is published in Annals of Mathematics. And it is only 2 years old. We will cover that. But for that, we have to introduce some new measures of complexity. So I will introduce new measures of complexity. It will not require anything from what we learned in last four classes. It's completely fresh, very basic. And using that, using those definitions, we will be able to prove Huang's result. So what is its result? Why is it important? And how do we prove? That's going to be the topic for next 2 weeks. Thank you.